Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast in video format and in podcast for your ears. Remember the Chorley FM coming in your ears. Anyway, this is the latest episode. I'm joined by Big Benny. Don't think about it. Thank you for joining us.
Very happy to be here, Billy. Ultimo Strachan. As I say, I'm sticking with that. I'm running with that throughout probably the full podcast. You're Ultimo Strachan from now on.
I'm happy with that. I should give a shout out to Alexander Darwin McCallan because he coined it on Twitter, and I think he'd be really annoyed if I didn't mention him for it. But yeah, I love that nickname. I've been called a lot worse. There was a guy in school. Just absolute true story. So it's already gone off the rails. Who used to call me Billy Pelkey. Never understood it. Called me it for 11 years. So from primary school up to high school. So I just went, why'd you call me this? And he turned around and went, oh, because it rhymes. So that was the level that I was dealing with in school.
I have no words. Like, when you said like Pelkey, I was like, is this some kind of like East Coast like slang word that I've just no been privy to, like in my sheltered wee.
I went to school with an idiot. So that was
I went to school in Bells Hill. Like if you're not an idiot in Bells Hill and you get ostracized as a weirdo.
I was coined as one of the smart ones in Rothes. So here I am now doing wrestling podcasts and that. So that's the last level we're working with. Anyway, that went well off the rails already. Let's go back to the normal questions.
Right, back to the rails.
Exactly, back to the wrestling. Right, easy question then. We'll go for the normal one. How did you get into wrestling?
I got into wrestling. It was actually because like I've been like a fan since I was like yay high. Like, I think, as I say, I can never remember the exact year, the exact, like, episode of Raw, SmackDown, that I kind of first started watching it, but SummerSlam 2000 is the first pay-per-view that I can, like, vividly remember watching. So I've been, like, an actual fan for, like, years, and then for actually getting into, like, training and stuff like that, it was actually my pal Jamie Conley, we'll give him a shout-out, first of many. I've been getting harangued for left, right, and centre, like, you better mention me, put me over. So, my pal Jamie Conley, we were at a house party, and we got to talking about, like, how I like the wrestling, you like the wrestling, I like the PlayStation, you like the PlayStation. He mentioned that he was, at the time he was training at Source, said to me, worth a punt, come along. So then that kind of kick-started me training at Source. I was there for like a good few years. Then took a lengthy hiatus due to a combination of lack of money, lack of time, and just general overall laziness. And then it was a couple of years ago now, I came back, started going to Respect, and then I've been there slowly but surely making a name for myself ever since across the Ayrshire area and beyond.
SummerSlam 2000. I watched that and the build up to this year's SummerSlam, because of working from home, I kind of get the time now to be able to watch the pay per views live. So I was like, I need to watch SummerSlam, and that was the one I picked because had TLC, it had it was just 2000. What a year, honestly, great year.
What a time to be alive.
Exactly. That was kind of well into when I started watching. That was perfect. Just for anyone watching just now, you may recognize my face from SummerSlam as I appeared in the Thunderdome.
I was watching it on the network. I was watching it during the day on Monday. And I was just like, I'd seen, like, also on Twitter, I'd seen, like, your screenshots, and then I was just watching it. I was like, where is he? I was like, Billy! Yeah! I was keeping an eye out for the final Velveteen Dream guy. I was like, man.
If anyone is not sure about the Thunderdome, do it. It's so much fun. Although, all it is you're watching the same show. You're watching it 2 minutes earlier. because of course there's a delay to get rid of some people. Didn't obviously work. But yeah, it's you just have a guy every start and end each match going, "Hey guys, tell us what you think. Cheer, boo, thumbs up," and I'm just like going, "All right."
I'm just picturing it as like, see the guy with the cue card, see at the wedding and Shrek. It's just like treble through applause, like come on.
Pretty much that's how it was working out. It's like, again, anyone who's thinking about doing it, open it up on your laptop, because I opened it up on my phone, and so the whole night I looked like I was just like leaning because I was trying to hold my phone still, because we were told in the rules don't move. And then or just be yourself. You're not allowed to have other people on the screen. So I spent most of my night going, "Hey, that guy's got two people on his screen. That's Pikachu. That's me. Can't have that."
Like it was child. How dare you, sir?
Exactly. Go away. You know, get that child out. She has to sign up for the Thunderdome too.
Pay your money or get it.
Anyway, so right about 2000-ish is when you remember starting watching. Any favourites from that time?
Every single person that watches wrestling has got like the one like WrestleMania that's their WrestleMania. And for me, like, it's WrestleMania 17. Like, 2001 for me is like absolute peak year in wrestling. Like, 2001 Rumble, I had that on VHS. Well, like, I recorded it because that was like one of the years where the Rumble was on Channel 4 for reasons unbeknownst to anyone except the executives there. Very thankful for it because it meant I didn't need to complain to my mom about paying for Sky box office. But I can remember I had the VHS for Royal Rumble 2001, which cut off like as Austin's like Pan and Kane with a chair. So like I'd spent years just never having seen the end of the match. It wasn't until YouTube came about that I finally got to see the actual ending of the match. Also I knew that Austin won because obviously like WrestleMania 17 main event with that heel turn success. Dubious. But it took me about, in fact, when was it? Just trying to like vaguely, so roughly about 10 years before I actually saw the finish of the match. So I think that's probably a record. Like, watched the match, it took me 10 years to finish it. And then eventually, when it finally happened, I was just like, good. Those 30 seconds that I'd never seen, I can now sleep well.
I think if I mind right, I also remember it being on Channel 4, and I think one of the ad breaks was after Triple H had just mangled Steve Austin, and it was just about to go to ad break, and Billy Gunn came out, and I was like, "Oh, cliffhanger!" I don't know why. It was 2001. Billy Gunn was not winning. Yeah, it's like, "Oh, it's number 28." It's no. Whatever number he was, 28, 29. Billy Gunn's like, "Oh no, we have to wait for the ad breaks. So we have to go through these Daz adverts before I can actually find out if Billy Gunn's got a chance."
I can remember because that was the year that like absolutely like I think it kills folk on like Sparkle quizzes. There's always one where it's like the final four for like every Royal Rumble, and it's like Billy Gunn was in the final four, and it's like, when would Billy Gunn ever be in a final four? And then you remember who his pals were, and it's like, happy day. Like, it's just an absolute pub quiz answer killer.
Yeah, Billy Gunn, Kane, Steve Austin, The Rock. Yeah, that's terrible trivia, but stump someone.
I can remember like that was, because I can remember when Haku came back as... I can't remember, it was somewhere between 27 and 29, because I remember Rikishi was number 30. But, like, Haku came back, and everybody was going mental, and me as, like, a, like, 7-year-old at the time was like, I have no idea who this man is, but everyone seems to be excited, so I'll just be buzzing as well. Like, yeah, it's Haku!
Yeah, exactly the same. It's like Jerry Lawler just shouting Haku, and I'm just like, yeah, Haku! Woo!
I'm like, yeah!
Remember that?
Yes, yeah, boom. That's what Haku is, right?
did we establish who your favourites were during that time? WrestleMania 17. So 17 was the best one. It's the best WrestleMania. So I'm assuming all your favourites must have been in the gimmick battle royal. That's why you're kind of bandying around the question.
Oh, the gimmick battle royal. It's a delight to watch back now, because again, that's kind of similar to like the excitement about Haku coming back. Like, most of them I had no idea who they were. I knew Sergeant Slaughter, and I found Hillbilly Jim funny because he made a funny face when he did his entrance. But the rest of them I had no idea who they were, and I was happy that there was some semblance of like nonsense going on. But then like going back and watching it now, that I actually like understand who everyone is, it just makes it like so much better. Because it's like I actually understand all these people, and then like Michael PSA is getting like the pop of the night. It's like, fair enough. Like, of all the people, I was like, to be fair, it is in Texas, that makes sense. Coming out with a big Confederate flag, like, cape, and it's like, wonder how he gets cheered.
But the best thing about that is that's his only WrestleMania appearance, and he's somehow in the Legends of WrestleMania game. So
doesn't take much.
And the best bit about that match, of course, is Sheik won because he couldn't go over the top rope, so...
Yeah, like, he just kind of, like, lumbles about and just casually... But what I love as well is the fact that like he wins it, and then Sergeant Slaughter, who wasn't even like the last man eliminated, I don't think, just get back into the ring and like Cobra clutched him anyway, and it's like everyone's cheering, and it's like, we've just watched one old man viciously assault another old man because he's salty that he lost a match, and we're cheering this man because he's wearing camouflage. Like, I'm a bit, again, like, mostly, I think now I'm kind of especially bitter because obviously wrestling, I respect pro wrestling, I'm very used to a sizable man dressed in camo getting cheered all the time. Hashtag Bobby Roberts. And it sticks in my craw. It should be my applause, but Bobby gets it all. He's the hometown boy.
Big Robert Roberts himself.
Robert Roberts. What a name. What a time to be alive.
Okay, so I've got a feeling it's going to be one of my favourite episodes to record, just from this alone. So, right, we're gonna dip back and forth as we always do. I think a lot of people, you're in Respect Pro Wrestling, people will know you from that. Maybe people on the internet might have got to know you a little bit more at the start of lockdown due to a silly internet tournament done by... A wrestling journalist news site who had nothing better to do. This was, of course, the tag team tournament that threw yourself and Brent Carter together, having never spoke to each other before, to
like
form
a delicious stew made of fate.
To form the Scrandalorians. If I mind right, Brent said that pretty much as soon as the draw was done, you messaged him going, I've got a name.
Well, it was because like as he said, like we'd kind of had, like, when we first get paired together, we kind of did like the interaction of like it was the Blades of Glory gifts going back and forth, which I'd just done purely because I was like, I don't really know the guy, I don't know what he's about, but I'll fling this his diary and see what it comes back with, and it was kind of responding well with that. And then he messaged me being like, all right, man, looks like we are like paired up together in this thing. And he asked me, I was like, if you get any ideas for team names? And immediately I just started panicking and I was like, I've not got a clue here. I was like, I don't know what he likes, what he dislikes. Is he into like the same kind of like stuff as me? Not a clue. So then I need to check through like the Twitter messages, because there was two that I fired through him. Scrandalorian was one of them. And obviously that was the one that we went for. We'll need to think of a team name as well. That was the other one. It was either the Scrandalorians, or the other one that I had that got rejected was the Riders of the Brohirrim. So, because I was just like, right, I can either, I was like, Star Wars and Lord of the Rings are both my wheelhouse. If I fire both at them, sure, like, God has to like at least one. So we could have gone like either way. We went for Scandalorians, and the rest, as they say, goes into the history books. But I feel like we definitely get a lot more mileage in terms of like the kind of like the puns for the managers and stuff with the Scandalorians, as we would have got for like Riders of the Brohirrim. Because I think Riders of the Brohirrim, like, I just thought, like, it's funny. Like, to me, in my panicked brain, of like, I need to think of something. Like, I need to make this guy think that I'm, like, funny. Ah, let's go for that. But I was Scandalorians, and then, as I say, just, like, the ideas that we were coming up with for, like, the managers. Like, my favourite one that I came up with myself was still Beef Cargo, which is just Carl Weathers dressed as a butcher. Baby Soda as well, like wee Baby Yoda with the Can Iron Brew, and then like C-3PO that Brent came up with. But for some reason, like when in my head I came up with Beef Cargo, it just completely tickled me. Just Carl Weathers with a wee butcher's hat and his apron on, just like on my apartments.
Yeah, Adam had a very rough time with all those graphics.
I mean, God bless Adam, because we put him through the ringer. We really did. But the same thing, because there was times where I was like, I'd think of him, I was like, he's going to hate me if I like pitch this one to him. But at the same time, I can't not do it. Like, I don't think there was anyone on the planet that was like happier that we get punted out as early as we did as Adam was. Because by God, he would have had a hell of a
sight. Oh, yeah.
He could have, like, taken a cent as a bill through, and I would have paid it because he's justified.
So from that point on, we seem to have created a nice budding friendship, which hopefully when, of course, shows are back around, that we'll finally see somewhere, whether it's Respect or FPWA. So yeah, as we don't have any structure with this. So about your training for Respect. So you did a bit at Source, but Respect's where you call home now, I would accurately say.
Yeah.
What was it like returning to training? Was there any apprehension on your body when that first bump hit?
It was actually, because it had been as long since, it had been about 4 years, a gap. But like when I was at Source, I was very kind of like patchy with my training. I was very kind of stop start. And again with that, like at the time, I would say, like, oh, like I've not got enough money, or I've not got the time, or I'm working or whatever. But it was just pure laziness and bone idleness on my part. So like when I came back to Respect, I was like, right, this time I can actually do it properly. So I've got my head screwed on. I can commit myself to coming like regularly to training and just battering about it. Like the first bump back, like, I mean, it could be my first bump or my 50th bump. I just hate it. I try to avoid bumps whenever I can. But my ultimate goal is to somehow like gain like 10 inches of height and become like this absolute 400-pound monster, because then nobody can bump me realistically. But we can but dream at this point. Just need to keep eating my greens and my Scandalorian goodies. But coming back in, like first session back was fine, because it was kind of took it like relatively easy, just kind of get back into the flow. Second session back, I tried taking a back body drop, went sideways somehow, whapped my knee like clean off like the canvas, while at the same time landing head first onto a crash mat. So then that kind of led to like my knee, it's fine now, but for like the longest time I had like soft tissue damage for like 5-6 months, because I just never went to a doctor to see about it. I was just like, I'll just battle through it. I wear knee pads anyway. So like I had that, but beyond that it was just a case of, because once I came back in, I very quickly kind of like picked up my stride again. Like it was kind of like riding a bike. Like once you do a couple of cycles around the street, you're pretty much good to go again. And then just because I was kind of very quick to get back to where I was at, that then meant I could get straight into improving upon that. So that's kind of, again, I've kind of had a forced kind of like, well, we've all had a kind of like forced break for training over the last few months. This wee bug going about, you may have heard of it. But it's now I'm just kind of get to the point where I'm kind of like chomping at the bit to get back in about it, because I've got like, I've been sitting like through lockdown just writing down like, right, stuff I want to try, stuff that I've been doing that I want to keep working on, other things like character tweaks. I want to try and get at least a few training sessions with like me and Brent so that we can actually try like training together as a tag team, just so we can kind of find like the mesh, because obviously I'll have my particular style, he'll have his, and it's just a case of finding that perfect meeting point where we can then like gel it together into like proper like solid tag team wrestling. So that's my kind of main goals for coming back, is get at least a few sessions in with Brent so that we can actually try and put the Scrandalorians into actual existence as opposed to its current status as in like the kind of Twitter sphere. And then I just like constantly trying to improve upon where I was at and just get better and better and better, and also put on weight, because for a Scrandalorian I'm built like the same as a fiver.
So you're more like a Scrandalorian at the moment.
Oh, I'm claiming that. Hold on.
Take it. You can have it.
Oh, I'm going it down. It's not like we're recording this or anything. I'll need to remember.
So it's all right. Just me, Jeff, listen back. It gets my hits up. So, what have you been doing since this whole COVID thing is happening, to keep yourself kind of active, or is it just been a case of just ideas, and a little bit of working out at the same time?
Well, the first, like when lockdown first started, it was a lot of PlayStation, a lot of Steam on the laptop, a lot of kind of just kind of idling about. When I was furloughed for work as well, it was a lot of just kind of sitting about, not really knowing what to do. Then I started working from home. I was working from home for about half a week. Then my daughter was born, and then so that's just kind of been for the last like 2.5 months, it's been fatherhood. So that's kind of kept me more than busy over the last 2.5 months. So it's been an interesting one. I'd say it's weird, like also like going from like not having a kid to having a kid's also going to be like a big transition, but especially like with everything going on, like it was kind of like really quite weird, especially like the first few weeks, because like we were kind of limited in like who was able to kind of come and see her. So it was kind of like difficult, because like there was like the vast majority of like my family couldn't see her like straight away, which was like also like massively disappointing. But we had to kind of, for her sake and as like mostly, and obviously like everyone else's as well, just had to kind of like keep the social distancing. But now, also as things are getting eased off, we've been able to get more and more folks actually meeting her, as opposed to just getting like FaceTimes or like seeing photos. So I'd say it was a long way for a shortcut to answer that question, but fatherhood is what I've been doing like over the last couple of months at least.
So I mean, it's a terrible thing. I mean, that the virus, not child, not fatherhood. It's a terrible thing to happen, but at least it's came at a kind of opportune time for you to get that kind of routine down as well. So it's bad. It's very bad at one point, but it's finding the positives and the scariness of all this.
Yeah, like the whole COVID thing kind of enforced a break on everyone that I was going to have to take anyway, because I was always planning on, once she was born, taking a couple of months out of training, just obviously kind of get as much time with her as I could and then go back to it. And then obviously COVID came about and everyone got a break for training. So in that kind of respect, it was like it kind of lined up nicely with the kind of hiatus I was already planning. Again, that's one small positive, and a overwhelming sea of negatives that is a global pandemic that, you know, kills people. But it's kind of meant that I've not missed like too much time, just because, or like I'm not like missing time while everyone else has still been able to do it. So I've not had like the FOMO of having to just like sit and watch everyone train and be like. So in that respect, it's been decent. But I'm now at the point where I'm kind of quite looking forward to getting back in about it and get back to building the Benny brand.
So you've been playing PlayStation, Steam. What's your game of choice right now?
Right now it's kind of bouncing between. I've actually, because I hadn't been playing anything on Steam for ages, and I've gone back to Total War Shogun 2, and it's completely off the back of playing Ghost of Tsushima, because, like, what a game. I've been bouncing between, like, that when I'm wanting to, like, just sit and properly, if I've got, like, a few hours that I can just, like, pile into it, I'll sit and play that, or if I've got, like, an hour here, like, a half hour there, I'll jump on and just play, like, FIFA or something like that. But yeah, like, Ghost of Tsushima has definitely been, like, the game that's had my attention. Like, I got it, like, because it came out on my birthday, and I was like, well, that's the universe giving me a sign there. And I've been playing it pretty much ever since, whenever I can, as I say. So, because I've always loved, like everything to do with, like, the samurai and, like, ancient kind of, like Japanese culture, like, Chinese culture as well. But Total War Three Kingdoms doesn't run on my laptop because it's getting old. So that's the plan, is to one day get a half-decent gaming PC, because I've got a list of games for Steam that I really want to play that I just have to, like, sit and stare at them as they fluctuate up and down in price, and I can do nothing but marvel at them and not actually play them. But Ghost of Tsushima, I'm getting close to the end of it, and I can tell I'm really going to be quite sad when I finish it. So I'm kind of trying to kind of stretch that out as long as I can. And then I'm hoping between, like, side quests and potentially, like, running through, maybe doing, like, a new game plus on it, if it can tide me over at least until Cyberpunk comes out, I'll be happy with that. I can live with that. That's a world in which I'd like to live, I think, if I can just go straight from one to the other without that awkward gap of, like, filling your time with, like, Rocket League and the odd game of FIFA. Although Fall Guys has been helping a lot also, because Fall Guys is hysterical.
I've seen people play it, but I don't have PlayStation Plus, so I've just, I'm paying 16 quid for something that I think I need Plus to actually get online, so it just seems totally useless for me. But yeah, it does look like a lot of fun. I mean, my gaming thing is Lego games, I've mentioned that before, but the last thing I played properly, like an actual proper game, was the Uncharted one. So I just started Uncharted 2, but I was just, most of my evenings now is either trying to think of things to do for the website or watching Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. from the start. So that's pretty much my lockdown for the last couple of weeks. So Lord of the Rings is one of your passions. Other than playing Lego Lord of the Rings, don't have a very fond affinity for Lord of the Rings. So what is it about Lord of the Rings that means I'm wrong?
I mean, for me personally, like, I mean, just for everyone, like, it's just objectively a wonderful, beautiful, triumphant thing. As long as we don't discuss the Hobbit films, like, the Hobbit films, they kind of get shoveled over to the side. They sit in a special wee corner with, like, Star Wars Episode 9 and Season 9 of Scrubs, where we just don't talk about them. Yeah, like, for me, like, the three Lord of the Rings films, especially the extended versions, I could watch them, like, each, like, once a week and never get bored of it. Because, like, it's been drummed into me for, like, childhood, because my dad's a massive Tolkien fan as well. So, like, from a young age, he kind of, like, got me into it, and then, like, he took me to the cinema to see them when they first came out, and then we get all the DVDs, then we got all the extended edition DVDs, then I got all the extended edition Blu-rays. I've got the audio book of, I think I've got Fellowship of the Ring and the Silmarillion audio books, like, saved on my phone for, like, a rainy day, and I've got my big, like, bolster copy of the Lord of the Rings. It's just, like, the story, the characters, Frodo's a wee pain in the hoop, but you learn to kind of live with that. But I love it, and especially as well, like, if you go on Reddit, like, Lord of the Rings memes, like, it's an absolute motherload for, like, potential, like, for hilarity. And it's got, like, everything in it. It's got, like, funny, tragic, sometimes terrifying. Like, that's the issue I had with the Hobbit films, was they turned the orcs, like, CG, which just, like, killed any kind of, like, fear factor with them. Like, you perfected, like, the formula, like, 20 years ago when you got a bunch of, like, massive guys from New Zealand and just painted them. Like, stick with that. Stick with what got you the dance, to paraphrase good old JR. But I, as I said, like, the three Lord of the Rings films, if for anyone who's never watched them, I would maybe watch the theatrical ones first, because the extended editions, for your first time going in, are, like, a meaty affair. Because I think, like, extended fellowships, like, 3 hours, 2 hours, maybe, like, 3.5 hours, and, like, Return of the King, you're talking, like, 4.5 hours. Like, it's not a film that you just, like, stick on in a whim. You need to, like, sit down and be like, I am going to watch Lord of the Rings. I have it scheduled in for this day, this time, scheduled break at this point for, like, food, and you just need to, like, go for it. Like, to me, watching Lord of the Rings, it's always an event. Like, you get, there's a million films out there that you could just, like, stick on, just like, oh, just pop on just for watching it. But Lord of the Rings, it's like an actual, like, you feel the need to, like, sit down, and it's like the evening is dedicated to Lord of the Rings.
I kind of get that for me anyway. If it always seems to be, I really want to watch Endgame, the Avengers Endgame, and it's obviously 3 hours long or thereabouts. But if I suggest it, or if my wife suggests it, she's like, maybe we should watch Infinity War as well. So that becomes a 6 hour block of the day that you have to, and your break is obviously 3 hours in. So that's your stopping point to change the disc. Because Disney Plus is just so frustrating to watch them on. I don't know if it's just me or what, but it, like, frame skips every 20 minutes, and it's so brief, but it's so irritating.
I've noticed that, like, certain films, like, I've been watching Disney Plus, you'll just get, like, the odd, but it's just, like, it's, like, the tiniest wee skip, but, like, it's just noticeable enough that you're just, like, every time. And as you say, it's like every 20 minutes. And it gets to the point where you're kind of like, in your head, you're like, then just put it off. Like, it's just going to keep an eye on me. But then you just suffer through it. And then you get to the end of the film and you're just raging. Just so angry because you've missed, like, collectively, like, maybe 3 seconds of screen time. You're like,
oh, yeah. I mean, we took 3 shifts to watch the one and only Ivan, which is 90 minutes long. But it kept freezing and crashing every half an hour. So it was just like, that's it.
Still not seen it. Also, it's been plastered over, like, whenever you click into the TV/media section of the PS4, it's, like, sitting there, like, as, like, advertised for, like, Disney Plus. But I've still not watched it yet. I've been going back through all the kind of classic Disney princess films. I say it's from my daughter. It's 100% just because I want to watch them, but she gives me an excuse. Like, she's not even 3 months old yet. She doesn't understand what's going on, but she likes the pretty pictures and the colours, and she likes the songs, so that's justification enough for me. So we've had, so far, we've had Mulan, Snow White, and Sleeping Beauty, and then I'll let her decide. It's either going to be, I've not watched Tangled in a while, so I think she might want to watch Tangled tomorrow. We'll see how she feels.
Last one I watched was Brave.
Which, I do love Brave. I've not watched Brave in a good couple of years as well. That might come after Tangled.
I get me with, like, big blocks. I don't know why it's about Lord of the Rings. It's just done nothing. I tried to read the books, didn't work. And then, yeah, I watched the first film, and I didn't get it. I didn't get the appeal. But again, it's objective. I'm sure I'll like something. I liked Scrubs season 9 for what it was. It was supposed to be a spin-off. That's how I'm treating it in my head, and that's how I'm watching it, as a spin-off.
You're losing that Ultimo nickname, mate. I'm sorry, it's flying away from your grasp. But
I get why people don't like it, and I'm absolutely on board with pretty much all the criticisms for it. And when I forced my wife to watch all of it, all 8 seasons, and she's refused to watch 9th, I'm just like there going, no. I went through the 9th season. You have to go through the 9th season too. So you know the pain. But yeah, I enjoyed it for what it was, but yeah, it's not Scrubs. It's not Scrub season, it's a spin-off. That's what it should be. Have you been listening to that Scrubs podcast at the moment?
I've not, just because like it's something that like I rarely find myself having the time to do. For some reason, like I can never like sit in the house and listen to a podcast. Like I need to be like out walking about to listen to a podcast. So I've not actually yet sat down and listened to like the Scrubs one yet. Which like I'm annoying myself that I haven't done it because I know it's something that I really do need to do. But I just need to like find the time where I'm like, right, I'm actually just going to sit and do this and then just go like episode one and just blast my way through. Because like there's certain episodes that I know I need time to like emotionally prepare myself for. Like the Ben episode, like that Ben episode, like I'm going to need some, at least a couple of weeks to kind of steal myself from that. Otherwise I'm going to be sat like Dr. Cox, just like slamming whiskeys, just greeting like...
And my lunch is the one that always gets me with a bit of the fray, how to save a life at the end of it. Oh man, that's just... Anyway, I'm advertising other podcasts here. No, listen to this one first, all the back catalogue, and then you can go and listen to Fake. This one first.
And the pantheon of podcasts is this one, then the Scrubs podcast.
Exactly. That's the top. That's the order. I don't know who's third, but that's definitely your top two. So, as we're totally off subject now, far away from wrestling, we'll go for Kevin Williams' special question that he asks every time. What's your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur is... See, now this is the question as to, with it being an underwater aquatic creature, whether... I mean, I still count it as a dinosaur. Can I say all this because I'm stalling because I've temporarily forgotten its name? Which is really quite awful of me. And it's Liplerodon, that's the one. Liplerodon is my favourite dinosaur because of all the episodes of Walking with Dinosaurs, like which I watched back when I was like 6, 7, the one that always stuck in my mind was the Liplerodon episode. Because I just, same like any documentary, underwater stuff is how you get me watching a documentary. Like, the savannas, like, the lions and antelopes of Africa. It's cool, but I can go and see them at Blair Drummond, but, like, give me, like, underwater stuff. So, yeah, Liplerodon, just for, like, that episode, where it's just this massive, like, horrendous cross between, like, a whale and a crocodile. So just this absolute, like, beast, like, a horrifying thing. And it just looked, like, so cool. Obviously, it's... probably not at all what it actually looked like, but just that rendition, like I loved it. And then I thought when I first watched the trailers for like Jurassic World, I was like, oh my god, they've got a Liplerodon. Then it turned out to be a Mosasaur, and I was like, close but not close enough for my liking.
Do you mind when Walking the Dinosaurs is on in the cereal in like Coco Pops and that, you would get the holographic Walking the Dinosaur cards?
Oh, I very vaguely remember, like, childhood cereal toys as, unfortunately, I would never win points for it in Mastermind. Like, the only ones I can remember was there was, like, I think it was, like, Euro 2004, I think with, like, Kellogg stuff, it was, like, a card that you put it in your disc tray in your PC. Like, those ones always kind of, like, messed me up, like, I never understood how that works. But... I know, I can vaguely remember the Walking with Dinosaur cards, but not enough to... I'd be lying if I said I could remember the exact... I mean, I'm assuming it's holographic dinosaurs on them, to spend that
way. It was those hologram cards, which pretty much you spent most of your time just, like, scratching it, so it made that weird noise. Yeah. I actually remember those discs you were on about, the rectangle ones. I got Michael Owen, if I remember rightly, and as a proud Scotsman, it's a bit annoyed because I got an Englishman. But, you know, so it's just me going, I don't want to watch it. It's Michael Owen. I don't want to watch it. But, dang it, that's fine. Say it as a proud Scotsman. I was also a Man U fan in my youth. So it was like double the worst because he was Liverpool. So it was just not me having it. For anyone watching, I don't follow football. I prefer the wrestling stuff now, so don't give me hate for liking Man U. I honestly don't care. he's already said something bad about Lord of the Rings. If he says something about, oh no, he says something about Liverpool now.
Blow the horn, summon the horns.
I know, football, no interest to me. It's as fake as wrestling, to be honest.
We're better at faking injuries, I would say. We're slightly more believable in selling getting hit than most footballers, and we don't get paid nearly as much.
That's the worst thing of it. So yeah, football, rubbish. Give me wrestling. We're going to somehow swing back to the wrestling for a moment. No segue. Any favourite opponents so far? You've been wrestling for a little bit in respect, and I've seen your name pop up in other places, but I can't think of them off the top of my head.
I've been kind of lucky enough. I've been able to get to like a couple of shows down south. I've done a couple of shows in Newcastle now, so I like to think of myself as an international star now. In terms of like favourite opponents, I'd say probably like my favourite match, just because of like how much fun I had with it, was a match I had against Broadway. It was a show that we did. It was like one of those like soccer, like football places where it's like on the five-a-side pitches. And I loved like that full show. I loved because like me and Broadway were the first match. Then I was kind of managing Jason Hyde in the middle of the card, and then the main event was me and Jason versus Bobby and Glendon Barr. So I kind of got to be like the big bad of that show, and I just felt like an absolute king. But the first match with Bobby, just because it was just like so silly, like the crowd were like really getting into it, and like we're kind of like having like the kind of back and forth, because you get some crowds where you're like you'll say something to them like, let me hear you, and it's just crickets. But then like they were like also I was kind of like playing up the whole being a bit of an arse, and they were kind of like giving it back like tight, and I was like, this is brilliant. And I was like just brawling out into the crowds, like taking folks drinks off them, taking a sip and cracking each other in the head with cans of Iron Brew. And it was just the inherent silliness of it, because we just kind of went out and had fun with it. Like, one of my favourite matches, just purely because I didn't feel any, like, pressure to, I didn't feel like I was, like, stressing myself, because sometimes I, like, stress myself right out. Like, with a match where I'm like, oh, God, right, I need to try and, like, right, we're doing this and this and this and this, and I need to do this, and at the same time, I need to, like, remind the crowd that they're supposed to hate me and blah, 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 blah. But with that one, I just kind of, like, sauntered out. Like, I kind of strolled it and then strolled back in. And a great time was had by all. Also, speaking of that night, I was threatened with physical violence if I didn't put over Jason Hyde. So I'd just like to say, Jason Hyde, an absolute consummate professional. What a man. If I was given the option, if I could have a one-on-one match with either Jason Hyde or Shawn Michaels, I'm afraid Shawn's going to have to wait in catering. I think that will fulfill the brief. I think he said he was going to bounce my head like a basketball, so I'm hoping I've averted my fate with that one, just to get my...
I'm just hoping he can't tell time, because I'm fairly certain I saw the tweet and he was like, put himself over eight times in 3 minutes in the start, so let's just hope that his 3 minutes is a lot longer than everyone else's.
It says first 3 minutes, but it doesn't necessarily state the first 3 minutes of the podcast, so I'm counting it as the first 3 minutes after you asked me that question, in which case I think I might be golden.
Yep, I'm happy with that technicality. I'll take it. So that was probably fair matches. Again, we'll go for the more standard wrestling questions as well. Who would you like to face next? Let's go for Scottish wrestling first, then we can do dream stuff and fantasy next.
Next, who would I like to say? Well, my wee creepy pal Sean Martin. Like, we've many a match in training together, but we've yet to actually get a match together on a show. So that, if not, even if it's not necessarily like my next match, at some point I'd love to get at least one match on like a proper show with Sean, just because like whenever we like we have matches in training, like we always have fun with it. So just being able to like actually do it in front of people just to see if like they enjoy it as much as we do. Like I'd love him and as well DCT as well, just because it's DCT and he's an absolute laugher. I love D to death. And then the last one, again, perhaps not straight away, but I'll work my way there. ADM's got the Respect Pro Wrestling title, and we've got a new model coming out. We're just waiting on it getting announced, and I've had a wee swatch of it, and I think it looked a lot nicer on my shoulder than it would look on his. So that's some kind of goals for the future, possibly. How near the future also depends on, we'll see how we go when the shows come back, but I think at some point, I think me and Mr. ADM need to have a little physical discussion in the middle of the ring.
I'm a little bit afraid now, because I'm sure that's his third mention in this podcast. I don't know if it's like Beetlejuice, where I'm just going to say that he's going to burst through the door.
Up behind my counter, like,
suddenly just being dragged off, just going, no, it's okay. Anyway, so that's your immediate kind of goals for people to wrestle. Let's say that in during this lockdown, big Triple H has contacted you and went, right, we want you in NXT. We'll give you a pick of the opponents that you want. Who are you picking?
Oh, see, that's the thing, because Keith Lee's just escaped me then. He's just popped up on Raw.
Oh, no, anyone. People could come back to NXT.
Anyone at all. Oh, fan Davidozzi. Oh, my spoiled wee boy here. I think Keith Lee, just purely because, like, if you watch wrestling and, like, Keith Lee's, like, not one of your favourites at the moment, I don't really know what you've been watching. Like, just have a word with yourself, because he's just got, like, everything. So, like, Keith Lee would be up there. I'd love to do a match with Buddy Murphy, just because, like, in terms of like the kind of like the style that I want to go for is kind of like quite similar to his, like hard hitting, like a lot of knees, a lot of, obviously he's a bit of a slightly more hench than I am, so obviously I'm not going to be like battering at Murphy's Law at any point, but I'd love to have a match with him. Seth Rollins as well, just again purely because he's been like up there as like one of the benchmarks for like the last however many years. As terrifying as it would be, I feel like I'd need to have a match with The Fiend at least once, just so I could say that I've done it. Like, I'd probably never want to do it again after that, because he's technically absolutely horrifying. But I think if I could get at least one match with The Fiend, because, like, his, like, entrance, like, at SummerSlam last year, was, like, the first time anyone had actually seen it, just completely blew my mind. Because I can remember I was in Bobby Roberts' living room at like 3 a.m. and like everyone's fell asleep at this point apart from me and Sean Martin, and then like The Fiend comes out and the two of us are just it was like different layers, like when it first when he first appears and then the music starts and you realise it's a remix of his old music, and then you realise that like the crowd's doing the fireflies and then the lanterns in his head, and you're just like, oh my god, like just layer upon layer of, oh sweet holy Jesus. So I'd love to at least once a tussle with The Fiend. I'm not going to be so bold as to presume that I'd walk away with a win on that one, but I'd like to say that I at least did it. I'll let him in at least once.
So I just want to put this one out here. Susie's spoken about a bald man with wearing camo. I'm thinking the biggest match in wrestling history, Big Benny, Big Show.
Oh, if I could coax Big Show, because I mean, I can never tell if he's retired or not, because he pops up for a couple of weeks and then he goes again, and then he has a Netflix show, and then I feel like I would have a certain stipulation in that I would have the match, but I don't want it to be Big Benny versus Big Show. I want it to be Big Benny versus Captain Insano. Like, we're bringing it back to the late 90s. I'm like, give me Captain Insano. I want the powerbomb. Finishing move of Captain Insano. Captain Insano shows no mercy. And Big Benny shows even less. And just sell out the Silver Dome, brother.
I thought you were going to go for a table match because his match with Cody, and when he lost the table match because he got his leg and he stood in the table. I was like, yeah, that's my kind of a stipulation over that.
You just, in your head, you can just hear the like Kirby enthusiasm music. You're like, oh dear, we're all in trouble.
So we've done your fantasy booking and done all that kind of stuff. If Brent wasn't a tag team partner, again, any tag team partner anywhere in the world, AEW, Japan, whatever, who would be your dream tag team partner after Brent, of course?
Oh, after Brent, well, again, my pal Jamie, that initially got me into the wrestling, he's been training at Respect for like the last, well, also not the last few months, but for a couple of months before the lockdown came into place. And we've always said that we'd love to do like a tag team. So if we could at some point, also we'll figure it out whether it becomes an honorary Scandalorian or if I have like a side project to go along with everything else. But if I had like my pick of the little, I'd have to go again just purely because like when I was kind of like first training in terms of like the original style, and I still like catch myself doing his stuff like to this day, I'd have to go Chuck Taylor. I absolutely love Chuck Taylor. Like, I just have always found them like hysterical. And as I say, there's just like certain things of his that like I'll catch myself that I'm like still doing. It's like when he does like the stomps into the corner, and then just like the next thing you know, he's at like the other corner, like still stomping away at nothing. And then just like the kind of like high pitched girly screams, which I'm somewhat ashamed to admit I'm capable of hitting those high notes when the situation calls for it.
Well, great answer. So AEW, so what's your current watching habits for wrestling then? Is it just WWE or is AEW, Japan?
My actual watching habits are like shockingly like non-existent. Like I'll watch like any pay-per-views, I'll watch a pay-per-view, I'll watch a takeover, and I'll watch like compilations on YouTube of like top however many moves of like this month of this year, Botchamania, because of course like I don't know anyone in wrestling that doesn't watch Botchamania. It seems it's the two constants, especially in like British wrestling, is Botchamania and The Simpsons. But like in terms of like I tend not to watch like Raw, SmackDown, like Dynamite, NXT, I don't like actually watch them. I just like jump on and I'll read like the results the next day just to get like a kind of like flavor profile. And then if like something's like getting particular notice as being like watch this, then I'll kind of seek it out and watch it. But I'm kind of very picky choosy because I don't want to, especially like if I'm working the next day, I don't want to be like sitting for like 1 a.m. until 4 a.m. and then like at the end of the 3 hours just be sat like, well, that was just a colossal waste of my time. Like, I'll snipe my stuff that I want to watch, and I'll pick and choose. But for the most part, it's a lot of reading with watching whenever I feel it justifies it.
Yeah, my pretty much is I'll watch the Raw, SmackDown highlights or NXT highlights on YouTube because it's like 10 minutes worth, or the top 10 that happens that night. And then, yeah, I'll watch pay-per-views. I mean, that's the only advantage, really, of working from home. Otherwise, I would pick and choose. I'd Rumble, WrestleMania. That's the only times I would take a Monday off. But since all this has kicked in, I think I've watched every WWE pay-per-view and TakeOver this year, which is just unimaginable because the other side of this wall is my bed. So that's literally my commute in the morning. It's just out the door.
Just like,
there.
Well, yeah, well, yeah. If you really wanted to like cut some time, you would just like Kool-Aid guy, just clean through the wall, like right, and at work we go.
Yeah, so that's the only reason why I've watched so much, and that's probably the reason why I was on Thunderdome, because I haven't mentioned that enough.
just a subtle mention, like as seen on the WWE Network.
Yes, you're welcome. Yes, I was was in that tag team match. I was one of the Street Profits. That's where we're trying to do payback. we're trying to get on payback, but I don't think I've got the energy for it because there's a lot of thumbs up and cheer, and it's like it's 3 o'clock in the morning. My wife's asleep. I'm gonna go in the room because nobody will be happy at the end of it. Right. Okay. So I think I've kept you for a good while now. This has been like the quickest recording. I'm just looking at the time now, thinking, how have we been on this long?
Have you actually been on? I'm curious to know.
Well, by my reckoning, probably just about maybe 45, 50 minutes, something like that. And
not bad.
We've actually fitted in quite a lot of wrestling chat, which is fairly rare for these kind of episodes.
And interspersed with a lot of like absolute chaff, but I'd say we've got a few.
Wouldn't be an SWN podcast without absolute rubbish being talked about, and because there's no wrestling on at the moment, so nobody wants to hear about it.
It wouldn't be a conversation with Big Benny without absolute rubbish being spoken about it.
Before you go, Star Wars, right? I know this could end up being a diatribe. I think the only Star Wars film that I saw in the cinema was Revenge of the Sith. So I don't know if that's
Of all the films to like go and see, because obviously, also the original trilogy I touched before my time. The kind of prequel trilogy, I went to see all of them in the cinema, so that was when I was younger, and then the sequel trilogy with mixed levels of happiness about that, I went to see all of them like the nights that they came out, like just going at midnight. Force Awakens I went to see in IMAX at 3 a.m. like the night it came out, and that is still, for all that it's a film that does have its flaws, it's still in like my top 5 like cinema experiences, just because it was like my first time ever at the IMAX, and it was just like Star Wars back after like 10 years, which doesn't seem like that long in hindsight, especially when you consider the gap between the originals and then the newer ones. But Revenge of the Sith is for me tied as my favourite Star Wars film. It's a 3-way dance for me between Revenge of the Sith, Empire and Rogue One. So of all the films for you to go to the cinema to see, Revenge of the Sith is a very good choice. Because while it's cheesy in dialogue and music and action, and again now in memes, it is unparalleled. It also gave us Hello There, and that's just like all you need. It gave us peak Kenobi. It was the Kenobi that we always wanted, but we never thought we'd get.
I enjoyed it, but the only thing I actually remember from that night is not even Star Wars related. It was the same night as the Champions League final, Liverpool AC Milan, that I went to go see it. So, I mean, again, not a football guy, definitely not a Liverpool guy, but just hearing on the taxi home, hearing the penalties about to start and thinking, oh my God, this is actually, we're going to have to go to run across the street to watch this now. It's like 15, 14, that was it, what would have been. And I was just like, yeah, I have to go watch this football game. I don't like football. Why do I watch this? Anyway. Because I had to see it. I had to see it for myself. Thank you for joining us. What's your social media? How can people find you?
Right, social media, you can find me on Facebook as Big Benny, the Big's all in capitals, the Benny, just the B's in capital. Twitter, at Big Benny DQI, Instagram, I want to say BigBenny.DQI. Yeah, BigBenny.DQI. Twitter's where I sporadically post about most wrestling stuff. Instagram, you'll get the occasional photo of my daughter, along with other equally occasional photos of myself in the quite, frankly, awful turquoise tights that I've been rocking for like the last 5 years. Fortunately, I now have new ones, so coming out of lockdown, you'll see the new and improved Big Benny that doesn't like blind you with the sheer like bright colouring of his tights. And I have any other social media. I do have other social media, but none that weren't used, seeing that's my social media.
No TikTok, no.
Oh, no, I leave that. The missus is get TikTok. TikTok's not for Big Benny. Big Benny don't TikTok. Big Benny used to Vine. Well, I didn't Vine, but I used to like watching Vine. And I've now, on account of all the like YouTube compilations, I've probably seen like every Vine that's ever been like made worth seeing. But nah, TikTok, it's just not the same. It's not got the same vibe. I don't like it. I don't trust it. It's new, and I'm not fond.
It's no tout. Right, so thank you for joining us. This has been our fascinating, very little wrestling episode of the Scottish Wrestling Network podcast. Hopefully we can get a part two done when shows return at some point.
I was going to say, we need to get a me and Brent together podcast, I definitely feel like. Because especially like with shows starting, that's another thing I should have mentioned when you're asking about like upcoming, well, matches that I would like to have. Spike Pro Wrestling, I've got some vacant tag team titles at the moment that I feel like it's a wee niche that just a couple of Scrandalorians could squeeze quite nicely into. So if we play, we'll play our cards right, I'll see what I can to butter up the boss at Respect, and because he does love butter, and hopefully might be seeing some, well, I say gold or silver, but you know what I mean, see some gold round about the Scrandalorian's waist sooner rather than later.
Well, I mean, I've experimented with a three, I was going to say a three-way, but that's not, a three-person chat, on Zoom. So hopefully we can arrange that. I've got a little bit of a backlog of interviews at the moment, somehow people want to be on. So we'll get that done.
We'll get a three-way scheduled with me, you and Brent. That'll go fantastic.
What a haunting thought. With that, I think I'm going to end it from there. But yeah, Ken, thanks again for joining me, and this has been a wild ride.